Good morning, students. Today we have a lecture on communication for health education. So this is a very important aspect when it comes to community medicine, or you can say as doctors you should know that communication is a very important aspect for us to communicate to people that how they can have a control on their health. So if you are going to educate them regarding health, then this would definitely bring down lot of morbidity and mortality. Now first we'll see communication. Now communication is a two-way process of exchanging or shaping ideas, feelings and information. So we know that in day-to-day practice we do communicate to exchange what we are feeling, so any information you want to give, so all this is communication. It refers to the countless ways that humans have of keeping in touch with one another. So we know these are basic things, and we know the meaning of communication, that it is the different way in which we share our feelings. And in health education it's important because by communication we are going to tell people or share our knowledge about health, and thus we would try to bring about changes in the community. Now communication, it is a process to pave way for desired changes in human behavior and inform individual and community participation to achieve this goals. Okay. Now what happens with communication is that we are mainly targeting our objective in communication would be at three levels, that is the cognitive level, affective level and psychomotor level. Now cognitive level means to bring about changes in the knowledge, okay, and then affective is the attitude component. And once you impart knowledge to people, you see that they are attitude is changing, then definitely this would bring about psychomotor, that whatever they are doing, okay, so the skill development, okay, so that aspect is at the psychomotor level. Then there are different ways of communication, the skills. It could be by speaking, okay, writing, listening, reading, reasoning. So in this session you can see that whatever I know, I'm trying to communicate and bring about this change in you. First is at the level of knowledge, because here we are going to have different aspects. Like when we see this chapter or any chapter, when somebody is teaching you, we are trying to do it at the different levels, like the cognitive. First we are trying to impart knowledge to you, and then when it comes to certain diseases, then definitely like you, for example diarrheal diseases or maybe any vector borne diseases. So we are trying to first give you knowledge regarding these diseases, the mode and spread. So definitely your attitude, like for diarrheal diseases, so it's the fecal route of transmission, so you're very careful regarding that. Your attitude is changing, so as to what you're going to eat, how you're going to eat, and definitely your few skills and all those will change when you get this knowledge. Now, a few examples of psychomotor development could be preparation of a ORS solution. So those skills could be developed by communication and health education. Okay. So here I'm speaking and I'm trying to communicate and tell you the important aspects in this session. Now this whole process of communication, it has different components. We have sender, the receiver, we should have a message, the different channels of transmission of this communication, and feedback, the most important component. So we'll just see this one by one. Now sender is a communicator. So in this communication what we are having, I will be the sender. Or if you are going out and giving health education to people, so there you will be the sender. So one, we should know what are our objectives, which should be clearly defined. So for today's session, I should know exactly what I'm teaching you, how much I'm teaching you. Okay, so this should be very clear. And we should even know our audience. So this is the most important aspect, is we should know what our audience need. Are you interested in it? Okay, so whenever you're going out and you're giving, you're communicating maybe for health education on any topic, first try to see if the audience is interested and is it his felt need. Does the audience feel that he needs it? Okay, then the message should be very clear. Okay, you cannot have very long messages and some terminologies which the audience is not able to understand. So all that should be taken care of. And then how you're going to communicate, maybe what are the different ways, like maybe a lecture or maybe on phone. So all these things, what are the various channels, so that should be listed, and you should know which would be the most effective at that particular time. Then the abilities of that sender should be known to him, his professional abilities, what are his limitations. So with all this, he should, the sender should be very clear about this. Now receiver. Now receiver is the audience who are going to listen to what we are going to educate. And again, the audience are different, their frame of mind, their opinions, their attitudes. So all this is very different. So we need to see what kind of audience we have, and based on that, your health education should be planned. Now, audience could be a controlled audience, which is held together by a common interest, and it's homogeneous. Like for today's lecture, you could be considered as a homogeneous audience. So you all want to study, you have taken admissions to MBBS, and you want to understand this subject. So this kind of audience is very easy to handle. Now the next is the uncontrolled audience. That is, they gather just out of curiosity. Something is going on, so they just want to check what it is. Here the audience is not homogeneous, and it's very difficult to speak or to communicate with such kind of audience. Now our message. So whatever is the message, it should be in line with our objectives. So what is our objective? You see that, plan your message according to that. See that it is meaningful, it is based on the felt needs of the people. Okay, like taking for example, if you are speaking to ANC, if you are speaking to ANC mothers, so keep your message regarding all those things which are required for ANC. Okay, the exercise, the diet, so whatever is needed. If you try to inculcate some other topic which is not much of need to them, so this would not be their felt need, and they would not listen to us, or the whole process of communication would not be very useful, nor to them nor to the sender who has taken all the efforts of preparing for that lecture. Now the message as such, it should be specific and accurate, and it should be, for that it should be timely and adequate. Means it should have most of the important components, not that we are just giving a part of the message and then the audience would not know how exactly to go about with that information, what or the communication, the health education what they have got. So it has to be accurate, adequate, and it should fit that audience. So we have just spoke about this, and it should be made interesting. So any communication, if it goes monotonous, definitely the audience would not be interested in listening to it. Then it should be culturally and socially appropriate. The audience should be able to accept it both culturally and socially. So this is a very important point when it comes to our community, where we have a lot of different cultural backgrounds. So here we need to consider all these points while preparing our message. Okay, So it is the right message to the right people at the right time. So we should understand all this. Now the different channels of communication. So in different channels we have the different ways, that is the interpersonal communication, or this is one-to-one face-to-face communication. Okay, then we have the mass media, where we can address a large number of people by TV, radio or the print media. Then we have another important media which is very important for our Indian community, that is the folk media. So we have different, I told you, cultures here, and we have different ways of communication, that is the folk dance, singing, harikatas, nautankis. So all these are things which people, because we have lot of people who would easily accept all these, so the health education could be in these forms, so people would relate or they would understand it very well. So because they are constantly seeing all these folk dances and nautankis or the harikatha, so if we put in health education, they would understand it and they would even accept it easily. Types of communication. So this is an important question for your exams. So in types of communication, we have the important ones: one-way communication and two-way communication. So other than this, we have other classifications like verbal, non-verbal, formal, non-formal communication. So we'll just see about all these classifications one by one. So one-way communication, also known as didactic method, and the most common example for this is the lectures. Drawbacks of this type of communication is that here knowledge is imposed and learning is more authoritative. The participation by audience is very little, and there's no chance for feedback, and it doesn't influence human behavior a lot. So we have seen, you might have seen in lecture classes, so it's more that the teacher is speaking and we get hardly any feedback from the students. So this is one-way communication, also known as didactic method. Then we have a two-way communication, also known as Socratic method, which is much better than the one-way communication, because here we can understand if the audience is understanding by the feedback what we are getting. So whatever their doubts could be cleared at that particular time itself. Then verbal communication is what we are speaking and we are trying to communicate whatever we want to tell to the other person. Next we have non-verbal communication. It's told that silence can speak louder than words. Okay, and silence is a type of non-verbal communication. So coming to non-verbal communication, it includes all the postures or bodily movements, gestures, facial expressions, which could include smile, raised eyebrows, frowning, staring, gazing. So it's even by this kind of communication, we can convey most of the things what we feel like. And as I already told you that even by silence, okay, you can communicate how you feel about any particular situations. Then we have formal and non-formal communication. So formal is usually which follows the lines of authority, and informal, also known as grapevine communication, it's usually the gossip circles and all, they come under this non-formal communication. So actually it's told that the formal communication has to be strong, and so that most of the, and if it's not strong, then non-formal communications would increase in that particular organization. Then the other communications are visual, which includes charts, graphs, pictograms, tables, maps, posters. So all these come under the visual communication. We have others like telecommunication and internet, and it is through the electromagnetic instruments. So these are the different types of communication. I have told you it's an important, it is important when it comes to an exam to know these different types of communications. Now, another important question what you could be asked is the barriers of communication. So, in barriers of communication, mainly you can classify them into physiological, psychological, environmental, and cultural. So, what are all these? We'll just see one by one. Now, physiological barriers. Okay. So, here it is when you have certain barrier because of the physiology, like difficulty in hearing or difficulty in expression. So, this is your physiological barrier. Then we have psychological barrier. Here it is the emotional disturbances, the neurosis, the level of intelligence, language or comprehensive difficulties. So all these will come under your psychological difficulties. Then the environmental barriers are if there is a noisy environment. We have a class going on and there is lot of noise outside. So this could act as a hindrance or it could be a barrier to our communication. Invisibility. If I am putting up some slides or I am writing something on the board and there is some factors like fog or something in between or such kind of thing where the clarity of the any medium which I am showing you for communication, if that's not there, then this would act as an environmental barrier if there's lot of congestion. So again, this is an environmental barrier. Then we have cultural barriers. Cultural barriers, very important ones are illiteracy, level of knowledge, okay, customs, beliefs, religion, attitudes, economic and social class differences, language variations, again very important one. Then the urban education. Okay, and the other few other examples are large, the rural population. So all these are your cultural barriers. So we'll quickly see these barriers of communication again. They are mainly into four types: physiological, psychological, environmental, and cultural. Now, health communication. So important about health communication is you should know the functions. So what you can do is for all these we have few other topics which are important, like function. In here we have functions of health communication, then we have health education, its principles. So for all this, if you make few mnemonics, it would be easy for you to remember during your exams. Now let's see the functions of health communication one by one. So functions are it gives information regarding anything, whichever is the topic that you're speaking about. So the most important thing is it should give information. Then the other important things are education. So whatever the knowledge is, you know, it can add on to that knowledge. It helps in motivation, persuasion, counseling, raising morals, health development, and organization. So what are all these? We'll just see this one by one. Now, information, so any particular topic and you want to know more about it. So by communication, this can increase your information. Now, education. So basis of education is communication. So education can help to increase the knowledge. It is often assumed that knowledge determines or shapes attitudes, and attitudes determine behavior. And so this is a very important aspect of preventive medicine. So the other important things are motivation. Now what is motivation is? It is a power that drives a person to act from within. Then the most important function, this is the most important function of motivation, that we can motivate people to translate this information, health information what we are giving, into their personal behavior and lifestyle. Okay, and it has different stages. Once you motivate any person, first he should have interest in the topic in which in what you're speaking. So the first stage is the person will develop interest, then he himself will think, he'll evaluate what you have told, and then he'll decide whether he wants to act according to what you have educated him or what you have communicated to him, or then he will decide. He'll just see, evaluate, and then he will decide. Okay, but again, this is not long lasting. Okay, now persuasion. Now persuasion is art of winning friends and influencing people. So persuading somebody to do something, like whatever you are communicating, then you should by communication you can increase this persuasion. Okay, so it is a conscious attempt by one individual to change the general beliefs, understandings, values and behavior of another individual or group of individuals in some desired way. Okay, so here we have few definitions which you should know, like persuasion, what is motivation, what is counseling. So all these could be asked in your why. Now moving on to counseling. Now counseling is a process that can help people understand better and deal with their problems and communicate better with those with whom they are emotionally involved. Okay, so you should understand counseling is a very important factor in diseases which have social stigma. So there you can understand the person better, and people usually don't easily come out of the problems. In such situations, counseling is a very, very important process. So it can improve and reinforce motivation to change their behavior. So it supports during crisis. It helps them face up to their problems and solve them. Then, so here in counseling, you're giving them choices. You're explaining to them the situation, and then you're making them understand the situation well. Okay, so that they can have their own choice, and you're not forcing them here. Then advising amounts to directing people. Then cautioning the various do's and don'ts. So all this could be explained by proper counseling. Now, the most important factor here for a counselor is that he should be able to communicate information. Then he should gain the trust of the people. Then he should have the ability to listen sympathetically to people who are anxious, distressed, and possibly hostile, to understand other person's feelings and to respond in such a way that he feels free to express, then to help them to reduce and resolve their problems. So you might have heard about counseling centers in case of HIV infections. So I told you again, this is very important for such diseases where there is stigma or people take time to come out. Okay, and they need somebody with whom they can share what they feel. Then raising morale, it is the capacity of a group people or a team to pull together persistently or consistently. Okay, so if we raise the morale, then they can all work together, and this is very important function of health communication. Okay, or communication, you can say. Then health development overall, by communicating you can develop the health situation in that particular organization. Okay, so, and overall, once the health overall, if you see, the health development will be there, then you have health, the organization itself would do nicely. Okay, then it's the health organization. Okay, now moving on, once we are finished with communication, we'll just see what is health education. We have different definitions of health education, so I'll just read the definitions quickly. Health education is the translation of what is known about health into desirable individual and community behavior patterns by means of an educational process. Then the other definitions are the process by which individuals and group of people learn to behave in a manner conducive to the promotion, maintenance, restoration of health. Okay. Health education is a part of healthcare that is concerned with promoting healthy behavior. Okay. Any combination of learning opportunities and teaching activities designed to facilitate voluntary adaptations of behavior that are conducive to health. Again, another definition is health education is a process that informs, motivates, and helps people to adapt and maintain healthy practices and lifestyles, advocates environmental changes as needed to facilitate this goal, and conduct professional training and research to the same end. Okay, another very important definition that is given by Alma Atta is a process aimed at encouraging people to want to be healthy, to know how to stay healthy, to do what they can individually and collectively to maintain health, and to seek help when needed. So this, among all the definitions what I have just read, this is the most important one. So try to understand this definition. That is, it's a process where we are encouraging people. So we are going educating them, and we are teaching them or encouraging them by themselves to that they should want to be healthy. So even if people want to be healthy, so if you ask anybody regarding health, so they definitely they would want to be healthy. But the other things are that they should know how to stay healthy. Okay, so this is our task. We need to tell them how they can do this. Okay, and in some diseases, it is not just at the individual level. It has to be collectively what they can do in a society to maintain health and to know when they need to take help. Okay, I would give a small example here, like for vector-borne diseases. So first, they should know that they want to be healthy, so they should be free from diseases. So to be healthy, they should know that they should protect themselves from any bites. Okay, they should not get any bites from mosquitoes or the vector which can cause disease. Okay, so this education, health education, they should know, and they should know about the vector even, that where it breeds, how it breeds, and that it is not just the individual, the whole community, the whole society who is staying there, they need to keep their surroundings clean so that they can so their society can be free from all these diseases. And if they should know about the various signs, symptoms of those diseases, so that they should know when they need help, and they should go to the health authorities when needed. Okay, then the aims and objectives of health education. First, it is to encourage people to adopt and sustain health promoting lifestyle and practices. So very important. Now we are speaking about yoga, meditation, okay, and the various nutritive factors to increase your immunity. So people should know all this, and they should adopt to such health promoting lifestyle. Then to encourage the proper use of health services. The other aims other than the ones which I spoke now, that is having a proper lifestyle, to seek help of the health authorities. The other ones are to arouse interest, provide new knowledge, improve skills, to change attitudes in making rational decisions to solve their problems. Okay, then to stimulate individual and community self-reliance and participation to achieve health development through all these individual and community involvement. Okay, then health education has a potential for saving many more lives than has any one research discovery in the foreseeable future. So in short, you should know that what is health education? It is that a individual should know how he can stay healthy. Okay, and first it should become his own felt need. He should feel that he wants to be healthy, and overall he and his community together, they should know how to stay healthy and to seek help when required. Okay. Important slide, the difference between health education and propaganda. So in health education, the knowledge and skills are actively acquired. In propaganda, it's just put into minds of people. Here in health education, they think for themselves, and propaganda, it prevents or discourages thinkings. It's more of slogans. So health education disciplines primitive desires, and propaganda just arouses and stimulates primitive desires. In health education, it develops reflective behaviors. It trains people to use judgment before acting, But propaganda, it develops reflexive kind of behaviors. It aims at impulsive actions. Health education appeals to reasoning and propaganda appeals to emotions. It develops individual personality and self-expression. Propaganda develops standard pattern of attitudes and behavior. So in health education, the knowledge acquired through self-reliant activity. The process is behavior-centered, aims at developing attitude, habits and skills. Whereas like in propaganda, the knowledge is spoon-fed and passively received. Process is information-centered and there is no change of behavior. Contents of health education. So mainly in health education, the contents what could be there are what we could include is the human biology, nutrition, hygiene, family health, disease prevention and control, mental health, prevention of accidents and use of health services. So all these are important topics and all this could be included in health education, so that overall the disease in the community could be brought down. Another very important aspect is the principles of health education. So this is an important question. It could be asked in your exams. So the first most important one is credibility, then the interest, participation, motivation, comprehension, reinforcement, learning by doing, known to unknown, then setting examples, good human relations, feedback and leaders. Okay, we'll just see what these are one by one. So credibility. So what does credibility mean? That the message received by community must be trustworthy. Whatever message you are giving, it should be correct. Okay, then the message should be scientifically sound. It should be compatible with local culture and social codes. Then interest. Okay, so whomever you are giving this health education, they should be interested in that topic. Very important what I told you is it should be a felt need. That is the needs people feel about themselves. Next is the participation. Participation, it is based on the psychological principle of active learning. And it creates a sense of involvement, personal acceptance and decision making, and it improves the feedback. So people should participate in this health education activity, only then it would be successful. Then motivation. So it is a fundamental desire to learn. Then what exactly is motivation is that you're awakening this desire. Okay, there could be certain incentives, that is the primary or secondary. So primary motives for could be hunger, then survival, okay, sex. So all these are the primary motives. And after primary motives, that is the hunger, survival, sex, you have secondary motives, which is praise, love. So these are the outside forces. And for them, you could have incentives, that is, it could be positive or negative. So positive, you could call it a carrot, or a negative incentive, which is a stick. So by this, you could bring, so this is one important aspect of health education. Then it should be comprehensive, that is complete. You cannot just give half information. So whatever, you make it more comprehensive. And reinforcement, okay, so you can it's not a one-time process. You need to keep on telling these important facts again, okay, to people, so you can reinforce the health education. Then learning by doing. So it is that if we do, it's going to, people will understand it more. So as you must have heard this proverb, if I hear, I forget, if I see, I remember, and if I do, I know. So always when you do something, you know it very nicely. Known to unknown, so always the flow of knowledge has to be from known to unknown. Then always take feedback so you know how you are educating and whether people have any problem with their understanding. So whenever you take feedback, you can change your the way you are going to health educate, or whether the topic is of their interest, is it of their felt needs. So that way you can think about your health. So the health education process. Leaders, okay. So we learn best from people whom we respect. So this is well known to everybody. You can choose some local leaders. So people will follow what they are telling. So in health education also we can do this. Very good examples are we have leaders. You have so many leaders whom people follow, and they have been involved in programs like Pulse Polio. Okay, so so this is one important principle of health education. Okay, so why leaders? Because they understand the need and demand of the community. They provide guidance. They take initiative. They are receptive to views and suggestions. They identify themselves, or their leader is somebody from the community. Okay, and few characters of good leaders are: they are selfless, honest, they are impartial, they are considerate, sincere. Okay, they are easily accessible, able to control and compromise the various factions. They possess the skill and knowledge of eliciting cooperation and achieving coordination of official and non-official organizations. So you should know that a leader, he has all these characteristics and people follow and they listen to them. So they could be included in health education. Okay. Now moving on to how to practice health education. So how can you give health education? So for it, you have different aids. Okay, you can have audiovisual aids. So audiovisual aids could be classified again into auditory aids, visual aids, okay, and the combined ones. So auditory, now you must be using most of them: the radio, tape recorders, microphones, amplifiers, earphones. You have few only visual, okay, and in that also you can classify them into not requiring projection and requiring projection. So not requiring projection, you know, it's a chalk and board, leaflets, posters, charts, Fresnel graphs, exhibits, models, specimens. So all these are under your visual aids, which do not need any projection. Then there are few which require projection, that is the slides and the film strips. You have combined AV aids like television, sound films, slide tape combinations, so all these. Then AV aids improves the quality of your health education. Methods in health communication. So you can classify them into individual approach, group approach, and mass approach. In individual approach, you have personal contact, home visits, personal letters, telephone. Group approach, we have lectures, demonstrations, discussion methods. In discussion methods, we have group discussions, panel discussions, symposium, workshops, conference, seminars, and role plays. Then we have mass approach, that is the television, radio, newspaper, printed material, direct mailing, posters, health museum, exhibitions, folk methods, internet. So all this comes under your mass approach. So now when we see mass media and the personal communication, so a few important points about them is: mass media, they reach the widest population, and in personal communication, what we can see is it capitalizes on warmth and understanding and knowledge of communication. Then in mass media, it gets public attention. And personal communication, it provides the opportunity for involvement, for asking questions, expressing the fears and learning more. Mass media supports for concentrated programs of long duration, and personal communication can get people to make changes in habits and discussions. And mass media is effective among those with above average education level. And personal communication is influential with average education levels also. Now let's see all these one by one. Now, individual approach is personal contact either through letters, mails, okay, or having home visits by calling. So you can educate people by individually contacting and providing information regarding or giving them health education. The group approach, that is lectures, demonstrations, discussion methods like group discussion, panel discussion, symposium, workshops, conferences, seminars and role play. In lectures, that is the chalk and talk method, a lecture can be defined as a carefully prepared oral presentation of facts, organized thoughts and ideas by a qualified person. So its effectiveness depends to a large extent on the speaker's ability to write legibly and to draw with a chalk on a blackboard. So it should the group should not be more than 30 people and the talk should not extend more than 20 minutes. It could be made more effective by using flip charts and funnel graphs. Now flip charts is that we have a series of charts or posters which are 25 to 30 centimeters, and here the illustrations could be shown or they could be flashed in front of the audiences. And the funnel graphs, here a piece of rough funnel or khadi could be taken, and these small cutouts or pictures, graphs, drawing and other illustrations could be used. Advantage of this is that we could pre-plan this and it could be pre-arranged in a sequence. We can easily carry these things from one place to another. Then we have exhibits, films and charts. So the disadvantage here is it is the students are very less involved and it's more passive. Then coming to demonstrations, demonstration is a carefully prepared presentation to show how to perform a skill or procedure. Here any procedure could be demonstrated. So we have just seen demonstration and lecture. Group discussion. Here we have around 6 to 10 people discussing. Usually they have to face each other. They can sit in a group or in a circle. Then they discuss about any particular topic. Here they can have a moderator who would see that the topic is not getting deviated. He would start the discussion. Then a person who keeps a check on time. Then another person takes down all the points and he summarizes it. So this is how there could be good and bad discussions. Good ones where everybody is speaking, everybody is sharing their view, and nobody is dominating the discussion. Okay. Then we have panel discussions where we have chairman, moderator, 4 to 8 speakers. Here we know we have no agenda, no order of speaking. There are no speeches. Audience are invited to take part. And the discussion could be more spontaneous and natural compared to symposium. In symposium, we have series of speeches on selected topic, no discussion, audience may raise questions, and chairman would make a summary of all what was done. Okay, so everything, summary should be done at the end in symposium. Then we have workshop, where we have series of meetings, and it emphasizes on individual work. The total workshop could again be divided into small groups, and each group will choose chairman and recorder. They discuss and solve the problems. Learning takes place in friendly, happy and democratic atmosphere under expert guidance, and there is always an opportunity to improve. Then it could be done by role plays. So here by small role plays, health education could be done. Then the others are conferences and seminars. Mass approach, examples being television, radio, newspapers, printed materials, direct mailing, posters, okay, health museums, exhibits, folk methods, and internet. Now, summary. So, you should all what we have seen in this chapter is what is communication. So, you should know the process of communication, what is a who is a sender, and what he should know, the audience, the different channels of communication. Then important one is again the message and then feedback. Then the next important thing what we have seen is the types of communication. We have seen one way, two way, verbal, non-verbal, then formal, informal. Okay, so these are the different types of communication. I told you it's an important topic for your exams. Then the next important one was the barrier we had. So the important is the barrier of communication. So here we see the four different types of barriers, physiological, okay, then we seen psychological, the cultural, social factors, the environmental factors. So all these again important one for your exams. Then we seen about health education. You should know the definition that is given by Alma et al. Again, an important topic is the functions. So before in communication we had seen functions of health communication. Then in health education, a important one is what it includes and the principles of health education, and then the methods of health education. So in methods we should know the different ones, that is the individual, the group ones, and then the mass media and all those together. Thank you.